Let's stand. We're going to worship our King this morning, and it's good to gather together as a body. I was reminded this morning about all the churches that are gathering together across just our city, but then across the country, and how the church is the body gathered together. And that's really cool that as we gather this morning, we are also gathering with our brothers and sisters and across the town. It's really cool. So this morning, before we start though, we want to introduce a new song that it's a vertical song, so it's a harvest song, and it's a newer one, so you guys will get it. I'm not worried, you guys are fast learners. So we're gonna teach you guys a new one this morning. You guys ready? Yeah? All right, here we go.
It's a doorway into heaven. It's the password to His presence. We give thanks. It defeats all disappointment. Fill the house with holy moments. We give thanks. Yes, we do.
Yeah.
John 15, it's one of my favorite passages, and I find great comfort in knowing that there's nothing that we can do apart from the Lord, because I believe then that there's the promise that he gives us the strength and to do what he's asked us to do. He gives us courage, he gives us wisdom, but all we have to do is cling to him. Anyone here that's just barely hanging on, you just cling to the vine, because that's where all of our source comes from. Not only is it courage, but it's joy and it's hope. It's love. It's like true healing and restoration. So we're going to just sing this really simple chorus again.
I am yours and you are mine. I'm the cup, you are the wine. I surrender my whole life. I am the branch, you are the vine. I am yours and
who holds on to us. Lord, thank you. Thank you that you're a God who prunes. We're thankful that you're a God who tends to us. And then as we stay with you, as we remain with you, as we abide with you, God, that you're the one that does the work through us. So God, we surrender to a loving God. We surrender to a holy God. We surrender to a God who has eyes to see things that maybe we don't even see in ourselves. And we confess to you, God, our need for you. A holy God who takes us and purifies us. We thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. I'm going to ask you guys to take a seat. I really love worshiping with you. Sweet, as we gather together and we sing. And we're going to show a video this morning of the Hope Center. And if you guys aren't familiar with the Hope Center, it is just an amazing ministry that we do here at the church. And if anyone knows my story, I have had quite a bit there's a saying that says most of our life is spent in a valley, like 80% of life is spent in the valley and just a few mountaintop experiences. And I can attest to that a lot of my life I have seen some lows of the valley. But it's been the church, it's been God working through his people that have come around and helped lift me up. And I believe that's the story for many of you here today. So I want you guys to turn your attention to the screen and check out this video on the Hope Center and how it is doing that very thing for those in the church and those outside of the church.
At the Hope Center, our mission is to provide tangible help and transformational hope to the Chicagoland community by providing food and basic necessities to those in need and sharing with them the love of Christ. Far too many people across Chicagoland are burdened with the weight of illness, job loss, poverty, and struggle. And for many, the COVID-19 pandemic has only intensified these difficulties. But there is hope, and that is what we seek to provide for those in need, whatever their circumstances. We believe wholeheartedly in providing a dignified and loving experience, and we are blessed to come alongside families and individuals in their deepest time of need. At the Hope Center, we provide fresh fruits and vegetables, meat and dairy, pantry staples, toiletries, and more. And as we work to meet physical needs, our Hope Center volunteers take time to share the story of Christ and pray with those who come through our doors with the desire to lead people to the one who truly meets their needs and gives them lasting hope, Jesus. Hope Center locations are currently at our Rolling Meadows, Elgin, and Crystal Lake campuses, but Hope Center resources and volunteer opportunities are available to everyone. So if you or someone you know is in need of help today, please contact a staff member for assistance. And if you'd like to join a mission to care for those in need, there are three key ways you can get involved. One, become a pantry partner. Pantry partners commit to donating one bag full of one item each month. Two, volunteer. Your time is valuable and we'd be glad to have you join us as we prepare and serve each week, no matter where you live or which campus you attend. Three, share. If you see a need, let us help meet the need. Spread the news throughout your network to ensure we can reach our church family and Chicagoland communities with critical resources and the infallible love of Christ. Our world is desperate for hope, the hope of Jesus. And that's exactly what we're here to give, and that's what you can be a part of today. So visit us at harvestbiblechapel.org/hopecenter to learn more.
We get to set up here the hope of Jesus, the Hope Center. We get to praise the Lord for the hope we have. So let's stand as we continue in worship.
Sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring.
a moment when the lights went out and death had claimed its victory. The King of Love had given up his life. The darkest day in history. There on a cross they made for sinners. For every curse is blood atoned. One final breath and it was finished. But not the end we could have known. For the earth began to shake and the veil was torn. What a sacrifice was made as a heaven. Oh.
We've been ascribing worship to the Lord as we've sung with our voices, and now we have the opportunity to honor him with our gifts. You know, for everyone who belongs to Jesus and follows him, giving is a part of our core values. It's one of the disciplines that we practice. And you know, the Lord says that wherever your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So we give out of a heart of gratitude toward the Lord. And whether you give in the ways that you see on the screen today, or you give throughout the week, or maybe you came today to prepare your gift in a box as you leave today, the blue box is on the wall, whatever you're doing, we just pray that you'll do that with a heart of gratitude for the Lord, for what he's done for us. So will you join me in prayer as we commit these gifts to the Lord? Father, we thank you for your loving kindness. We thank you for the ways that you have provided for us that we are aware of and the ways that we don't even see. God, we thank you that we can love you because you first loved us. And so, Lord, we just commit these gifts to you, our tithes, our offerings, whatever we've brought to you today, Lord, we commit them to you for your use, for your glory, to advance the gospel of Christ here and around the world. We commit these things to you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you can be seated. Well, welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel. My name is Sherry Smith, and I serve on staff as the Director of Communications, and it's so good to be together today to worship the Lord. Maybe this is your first time here, and if that's the case, I would love the opportunity to meet you after the service. Out in the middle of the lobby, there's a banner that says, Welcome, and I'll be there afterward, and just be great to just put a name and face together to answer any questions you have about the church. Just be a great privilege to meet you. You know, for everybody, whether you're new or you come every week, our staff really loves communicating with you to know what's on your heart, what burdens you're carrying, what questions you have. So if you want to take out your phones and go to the Harvest Bible Chapel app, and there's a connect card there, and you can start that conversation. Our staff would love to follow up with you this week to get back to you and to care for you. That's really the purpose of that. If you don't have the app, you can use the QR code on the back of one of the seats in front of you. You know, we gather on the weekends, and throughout the week, many of us are growing in groups, and then we have the opportunity to go out on mission for Jesus. And one of the great ways we have to do that is coming up on Saturday, October 1st, which is next Saturday, from 9 to noon in the morning, we're going to do Serve Our City. It's a great way for us to go out into the community and show the love of Jesus in some tangible ways. There are four or five different ways that we can be involved here at the Rolling Meadows campus, but this is for all of our campuses. So wherever you are, you can get involved. You can get all the details and register today at harvestbible.org. Hey, women, you know, the guys are at camp this weekend, but we have something really fun and exciting coming up for us. On Saturday, October the 15th, all the women from all of our campuses are going to meet together at the Elgin campus for a morning we're calling the Women's Gathering. There will be workshops, and there will be worship, and there will be time in God's Word together, and just time in community as women from all across our church. So we hope that you'll be there. It's a free event, but we'd love for you to come and let us know that you're coming. So you can register today at harvestbible.org. You know, each week we pray for a local, like-minded gospel-preaching church in our area, and today we're going to do something a little different. We're going to pray for Harvest Bible Chapel. We just want to commit this church to the Lord for what he's doing. We also want to pray for the guys as they're finishing up their time at Camp Harvest at the Men of God retreat. And so I just want to invite you to join me in prayer. Father, we thank you for who you are. We thank you that this is your church. God, we thank you for Harvest Bible Chapel and the things that you're doing here. Lord, we pray that we might be found faithful in your eyes. God, that we'd be in alignment with your word, that we'd be people who are actively telling people about Jesus. So, Father, we just commit this church to you, Lord. We know that your word says that upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And so, Father, we just pray that we will be good stewards of what you've entrusted to us. God, that you will just show your favor to us and your kindness, and that this will be a light for the gospel in this community. Father, we also pray for the work that you've been doing in the guys' hearts and minds at Camp Harvest this weekend for the Men of God retreat. And Lord, as they're just finishing up this morning, I just ask that you would seal your word to their hearts. Maybe some have made decisions that they don't want to go back to the life the way they had it before. Or Lord, they just know you better, or they're in better community. So Father, I just pray that this would be a stake in the ground, that they might go forward closer to you because of the time they've spent there. Lord, we just commit the rest of the service to you, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, now I want to invite you to stand up, and I'd love for you to meet someone that you didn't come to church with today. And after that, we're going to get into God's Word in Acts chapter 6.
Hi there, it's great to have you join me. I'm actually doing this on Friday morning in an empty room here at Rolling Meadows. So my jokes will go over about as good as they usually do. I'm up at the camp right now, and I'm spending time, not right now, but like I will be up at the camp by the time you watch this, and we'll be at the Men of God retreat, and so I'm really excited about all of that kind of thing. But I really did want to be able to share this passage with you. It's meant an awful lot to me and has a very central part to play in the way that I understand ministry and the way that we as a church want to move forward in the days ahead. And so it's kind of God's intention for this to be a little bit of a vision-y sort of thing, but also it's so fantastic that it's in the midst of our teaching about Acts. So Acts 6, verses 1 to 7 is where we'll be in the next few minutes. So you have a Bible, you can open it and turn it to there. I want you to imagine with me a church plant. I've often thought church planters are kind of the entrepreneurs of the Christian church community. They are kind of my heroes. I don't know how anyone does that, goes out and just starts a new church out of nothing. I've often thought the people who do that are just amazing. So when I talk about a church plant, I'm talking about one of my favorite subjects and my favorite ideas regarding the church, this new work of God in a particular place. But I want you to picture a church plant that was started, like most church plants, as plants with a vision to reaching out into their community. You know, they're planted in some location, maybe in Chicagoland, and they're going to reach out into the community. They've connected with other churches in the area. They've realized that there is a real need for a gospel church in that area, and they really do want to connect with as many people as they possibly can. So in order to do that, they realize that in their area, there's a kind of a low socioeconomic group. And so they decide they're going to start a soup kitchen, right? So this pastor and his core team, they go and they volunteer at this soup kitchen that they've begun. Now, the first week, there's a few people there, but as word spreads, there's more and more people from the community coming in, people from all sorts of walks of life, you know, families who just don't have enough on a given day. You have people who are homeless. You have folks from all sorts of racial backgrounds. But particularly, there is a large group of African-American folks and a large group of white people who seem to be kind of in equal numbers. They seem to be coming at the same time. Similarly, the church itself, the leadership of the church, is sort of split between African-American and white leadership, and so the church itself, or the soup kitchen, and then the church is reflecting that kind of leadership makeup. I want you to imagine, though, that there is a problem that arises as the soup kitchen continues. There are some times where the white people are serving the soup, and other times where the African American people are serving the soup, When the white people are serving the soup, when the African-American people coming to get the soup hold their bowl out, they get a portion that they perceive to be less than what the other white people are getting who came to receive from the soup kitchen. At first, they're like, that's probably not a big deal. It's just our perception. But the more they start talking to each other, have you noticed that when I go through the line and the white people are serving us, that we're not getting quite as much as the other white people who are getting it? The other African-American folks says, yes, I have actually noticed that. I've kind of been thinking about it a little bit, but I didn't want to say anything out loud. Some of the grumbling starts to move through the little community, and it raises up to the point where some of the people who are part of the leadership of the church who are African-American, they get approached by their African-American friends, and they say, hey, you know what, we think that your white partners in ministry are actually kind of, you know, skimping on the soup for people who are black. We don't know why. I mean, we don't want to assume necessarily anything, but it feels like it's happening because of our race. So the African-American folks, when the next time they have a meeting of the church leadership, they bring us up, and they say, you know what, this is a perception among people. Well, some of the white leaders hear that, but then they're like, you know what? You guys just are too sensitive You're making a big deal out of a little thing. It's not intentional. We will try our best to fix it. Of course, the African-American people, why are you getting so upset about this? I mean, you do realize that we have a history of being kind of marginalized and treated less than, okay? And maybe this is not one of those cases, but you can understand why we would feel this way, right? And white people are like, yeah, fine. But as time goes on, they start to realize that actually this is something that is happening. Then African-American people keep pushing back. And so eventually the church has a meeting. That's how you solve all church issues. You have a business meeting. And so they gather together and they have this church meeting. They're going to talk about this particular issue. And as the meeting goes on, it starts really peaceful, but you can see the camps starting to divide, and they kind of follow racial lines, and eventually they start yelling at each other, and they're angry with each other, and things are said that weren't meant to be said, and offense was taken by people who shouldn't have taken offense, but the whole church just explodes on that day. Everybody ultimately blames the pastor and his leadership team for not stepping in and doing the right thing. Of course, their view of the right thing is different depending on what team you're on. And then the church dies. That story's made up, but not really. The landscape around us is littered with churches that have fallen apart due to infighting. They're churches that start with a view toward the mission of God. They want to reach out to their community, but eventually they get sidetracked by divisions that are driven by politics or sometimes just pettiness. And the church withers. Its focus on the mission and reaching out dies because of the distraction and the division of what's going on between the people. It's interesting if you look through the book of Acts, which is what we're studying here. We're in Acts chapter 6 today. But if you look through the beginning of the book of Acts, what you'll realize is that there's a few things that Luke, the author, brings up that are threats to the mission of God going forward, right? For people hearing the gospel message and responding in repentance and faith. There's certain things that can happen that will stop that mission from moving. I mean, one of them is, as we've seen already up to this point, persecution. You know, religious leaders, the Jewish religious leaders come in and they want to stop the apostles from preaching and teaching. And so they tell them, don't you do this anymore or else. Beat them, in fact, on some occasions. Another way that it stops is hypocrisy within the church itself. In Acts chapter 5, there's this couple named Ananias and Sapphira, and they lie to the church about how much money they have given to the church. They want everyone to think more highly of them than they probably should, so they lie a little bit, you know, pad their stats a little bit so that everybody thinks more highly of them. And of course, Peter in that moment says, you've lied to the Holy Spirit, and these two people die. It's almost like Luke is saying by putting this passage there, you know, hypocrisy will kill this whole mission. You know, if people look at the church and they say it is filled with people who say one thing and do another, it's not going to work. And then there's this. Division. Distraction by division. In this passage we're going to study here, that's what we're talking about. How does the church avoid death by division? What's interesting about the passage before we get into it is in the first verse of it, in these days when the disciples were increasing in number, a complaint by the Hellenists arose against the Hebrews. And so this is the issue that they're going to deal with. But before it happens, they're increasing in number. And then if you go to the very end of the passage, in the last verse, it says, and the word of God continued to increase, and the number of disciples multiplied greatly. So it begins with the increase of the disciples. It ends with the increase of the disciples. The question is, what did they do in the middle to deal with this complaint in order to protect the mission from being sidetracked? How, in other words, do you avoid the mission getting killed the focus of the church on its community getting killed by infighting, by division, by distraction. Because this is something, I hate to tell you, that we still do, right? There's all sorts of distractions and divisions within the church. How do we know that those things are going to happen? It's kind of natural for them to happen because we're sinful people, but we don't want it to stop the mission going forward like it has in so many other churches who have shown up for a moment and had a great impact in their community and then died because of some political issue or pettiness. How do we avoid death by division? Look, in this passage, I'm just going to point out two things that seem to happen here. One, these people were uncompromising in their calling. That's one of the ways they stopped from getting distracted. They were uncompromising, the apostles, on their calling. And second, they were compromising on their power. So if we want to move forward in integrity and fullness and impact, it seems to me that we need to be uncompromising on our calling and compromising on our power. So let's walk those two one after the other. Here's the first: be uncompromising on our calling. I want you to look at verse 1 in Acts 6 again with me. Now in these days, when the disciples, as I noted, they were increasing in number, so more and more people coming to faith in Christ, a complaint by the Hellenists arose against the Hebrew. I need to deal with these two terms, Hellenists and Hebrews. What you need to know is that if you looked inside the Christian community in Jerusalem at the time, what you would find is there was kind of two racial groups there. But they were all Jewish, okay? Everybody was Jewish, but there was sort of a cultural background piece. So maybe the wrong thing to say is racial groups. You had Jews, some of whom had stayed around Jerusalem, had lived in Israel, lived near the temple. They tended to be people who were perceived to be more pious and committed to the temple, to the law of God. And then there were others, for a variety of reasons, might have been moved outside of Israel over the years. Maybe it was because in the Babylonian captivity, they were taken far off and their family just stayed there over the years. Maybe it was during the Roman Empire, it was easy to travel. So maybe some people just traveled, you know, just like you might decide, hey, I want to move to San Diego, and you go and live in San Diego. And, you know, they moved to Greece and they thought Greece was lovely. But now they've come back. There's a group, what divides them is usually the language, their first language, right? Most of them knew Hebrew, but the Hebrew Christians didn't know Greek very well. And the Greek Christians, the Greek Jewish Christians, they spoke Greek. And so in the gathering, you could figure out who was who. Now, what's important for you to know is that if you were a Greek-speaking Jewish Christian, you were viewed as being kind of culturally inferior to the Hebrew. I mean, you'd mixed and mingled with a foreign culture, which was kind of against the law of God in all those days gone by. Remember, you're supposed to move into the land that you're not supposed to mix or mingle with. Don't marry their wives and don't mix and mingle with their gods. So there were some people who were Hebrews who looked at the Greek-speaking folks and said, you know, you guys have kind of given in to the Greek way of thinking. You're not as culturally pure as we are. And you're not as religiously pure as we are, because if you really cared about the law of God and the service of God at the temple, you would have showed up in Jerusalem and done those duties. So you can imagine in this community, what you've got is a bunch of Greek-speaking Jewish Christians who like to stick together because they thought of themselves as being less than. And the Hebrew folks were like, yeah, you kind of are less than. You have an immigrant community who's moved from afar, who sounds different in what they say, and they're primed for offense. You know that. I mean, lots of immigrant communities around the world, they're primed for offense. It might not be intentional or anything, but they get sick of the stink eye that people give them. You look different. You sound different. So you've got these two groups, and what's going on here is that a complaint, all right, a murmuring, a talking behind the scenes has arisen. Why? Well, because their widows, and by their we're referring to the Hellenists, their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution in Israel at the time. If you were an orphan or a widow, you had no man to help you out and deliver you from the harms of the society as a whole. You needed a man in order to get money because he was the only one who could work, usually. Or he's the only one who can make a significant income. You had to be tied to your father. You had to be tied to a brother. You had to be tied to a husband. So if your husband dies and you're an older woman, you went into great threat of poverty. So the churches would come around and they created these things called widows' rolls. They looked around and they said, well, who's a widow in our community so that we can take care of them and make sure that they don't fall into poverty? So the church had rolls of widows, you know, like names, lists of widows that they were going to take care of. In this case, some of those widows were from the Greek-speaking Hellenist group, and some of those widows were from the Hebrew, you know, stay at home in Jerusalem and be religiously pious group. But there's this feeling among the Greek-speaking folks that, you know, they're not getting as much soup as the Hebrew widows are. And so what you've got is a murmuring, a complaint that starts to spread. It starts to spread around. Can I just pause just for a second? Because I do want to point something out here, right? Isn't it interesting how petty divisions have always been a challenge for the church? When I read this passage, I'm like, oh my goodness, you're just like us. Not specifically maybe in this area, although the church has, in the United States, has its own challenges with, you know, racial issues and things these days. But some people will end up saying something like, oh, if we could just get back to the New Testament church and just, you know, be pure like them, you know, where they were sharing everything and stuff. And that was true. You know, Book of Acts says stuff like that. But it's also true that Ananias and Sapphira are there. It's also true that this kind of thing happened. This kind of petty infighting happens. The truth is, they were just like us. There's no need to go back. We're experiencing the same thing right now. Later on in the book of Acts, there's this really interesting section where the Apostle Paul and his buddy Barnabas, who are like they're missionaries teaming together to travel all over the place. In Acts 16, it says that they have a sharp disagreement over whether or not this guy, John Mark, who they took along on their first trip and kind of bailed out halfway through, whether on the second trip they should take him along. And Barnabas is like, no, we should bring him along because we should be compassionate and kind, and everyone loves a second chance. Everyone deserves one anyway. This could be a redemption story, Paul. And Paul's like, listen, mission work is not for the faint of heart, and John Mark is the faint of heart, so he can't come. Barnabas, we should bring him and employ him. Paul, no way, get rid of him. And so there's a sharp disagreement. I love reading that passage because I'm like, oh my gosh, just like in our church today where sharp disagreements happen. It's almost like Luke is trying to say that you should probably expect some of this stuff to happen, these ruptures. The question isn't how do you stop them? The question is, what do you do when they take place? What do you do so that the mission of the church doesn't get sidetracked by those kinds of things? And so this is what we're dealing with here. So let's see what they did. The 12 then, 12 apostles, right? They summoned the full number of the disciples, which would have been thousands at this point. There's a lot of people, you know, coming to faith in Jesus and they're disciples of him. And so they gather together and they have a business meeting. And they said, the apostles said, look, it's not right that we should give up preaching the word of God to serve tables. Now, what you need to know at this point is they're not saying, look, The serving of tables is beneath us. Do you not know who we are? Like, I'm Dr. Peter. I'm not going to spend my time with the riffraff. That's not what they're doing. It's not an elitist kind of thing. They're also not saying that the serving of tables is unnecessary or meaningless. They recognize by addressing the issue that this is an issue that needs to be dealt with. It's an important issue that is bringing division to the church. But they are saying, so they're not saying those things, but they are saying that the word of the God, if it stops being proclaimed, the mission will die. The whole thing is built upon the proclamation of the word of God. It is the fuel for the mission, which is why we're here. And this thing, this little fight that's going on in the community, has the potential to pull us to the side. We will not let that happen. Now, I want you to see their rationale here, okay? Why it is that they're so adamant about the preaching of the word of God. Because if you go in other parts of scripture, one of the things you find very quickly is the proclamation, the preaching of God's word is the thing. It's the switch that allows people, that gives people the opportunity to come to faith in Christ. In other words, if you do not preach, they will not come. Somebody has to go out and call them with the gospel. Romans 10:14, Paul writes, how then will they call on him, right? You want people to call on the name of the Lord that they might be saved. How will they call on him in whom they've not believed? But how are they to believe in him of whom they've never heard? You want them to believe, but in order to believe, they have to hear. And how are they to hear without someone preaching? The only way for them to hear is preaching. Or I should do the arrows the other way. See, the preaching of the word means that they hear the word and that they believe. So if you want people, and ultimately then they call upon the name of the Lord. So if you want people to call on the name of the Lord and be saved, it starts with proclamation of the word of God. If you stop that, if you just go out and do, you know, social work, as important as it is, and it is, you've basically turned off the spigot of the mission. Another verse that says similarly, Paul writes in 2 Timothy 3, all scripture is breathed out by God. It's God's very word. And it's profitable for teaching, reproof, correction, and training in righteousness. So scripture is profitable for these things. So that, what's the purpose of it or the result of it? The man or woman of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. If you want to grow people in Christ and equip them for the work of God, if you want to equip them with the ability to do the right thing, the way you do that is you give them the Bible. The way you do that is you proclaim the word of God. That's why Jesus said in the Great Commission, you know, make disciples of baptizing and teaching them to obey all that I commanded you, because that's how you make a disciple. If you stop teaching, if you stop proclaiming this scripture, not only will people not hear and believe, the people who hear and believe will not grow. Everything regarding the mission rests upon consistent, careful proclamation of the word of God. And the apostles, they know this. You guys ever seen those, they call them air dancers? They're usually in front of car dealerships or, you know, a laundromat who wants to draw attention into their business. You have the guys out in front sometimes who have the signs, hey, come in here, come in here. And then other times they just, you know, they get this air dancer, which is basically a balloon shaped like a human being, and they blow air through it, and it flops all over, and it's hard when you're driving. You're like, what is that? And then you realize, oh, it's just an advertising ploy. I've seen one of those that is, like, drooping badly because the little air blower that blows into it is not pumping out enough air. Or if you shut it down, it just drops to the ground. This is a really good image for what the apostles believed, that if you stop If you stop the proclamation of the word, the blowing of the Spirit's work through the proclamation of the word of God, it will stop the dancing of the gospel. It will stop it. So you always got to make sure the air is blowing, which is exactly what they're trying to do. So my point is really simple. The apostles don't compromise on their calling. The best thing they can do for the church is to preach and to pray. The best thing they can do is not settle the issue, as important as it is. It's to stick to the preaching and the prayer. Unfortunately, the threat of distraction like this and division is as real for us as it is for them. So let's turn from what they're facing and let's think about similar things that we face. This is kind of me stepping to the side now and saying, let me give you a few examples of where I think this kind of thing has been happening in the church recently. And you can disagree with me about the specific examples if you like. But here are three of them over the last, 20 years or so that I've seen as a Christian. The church get it distracted into a political game or into some infighting or something, and the mission just kind of dying. One of them was back in 2003, I think it was when the Iraq War first began. I remember talking to a friend, and I said to them at the time, you know, I don't really know much about the weapons of mass destruction claim. Those of you who remember those days, it was claimed that Iraq had these weapons of mass destruction, so the United States was going to go into Iraq in response for what happened supposedly at 9/11. And when I say supposedly, it didn't seem like there was a lot of evidence that Iraq was involved, but the belief was, oh, Saddam Hussein has all of these weapons of mass destruction, so we got to go in and we got to take care of it. I remember asking my friend, who was very adamant that this was something that we had to do. I remember asking my friend, do you ever wonder how this action by the United States will affect the gospel and its proclamation among the people of Iraq? I mean, a lot of those people equated the West with Christianity. So if the West comes and they start attacking the Iraqis, I was just wondering, how is the mission affected by that? I remember my friend getting very upset with me. He said, aren't you an American? I was like, yes, I am an American. But I'm a Christian first, right? Like the United States and its foreign policy can succeed or fail. The United States economy can succeed or fail. That's not going to change any of my commitment to Christ. I'm a Christian first. And yes, are these important things? Yes, it's very important that we bring justice in places where injustice is taking place. And I cheer for the U.S. when it does that. But the real question is about the gospel and its proclamation. All right, another example. A little closer to home. You guys remember a few years ago, it's only been a few years now, where the whole riots over the George Floyd killing happened. I was, of course, outside of the country at the time, so I felt like I had this sort of perspective on it where I could hear, I was just sort of watching as an outsider to some of what was happening in the United States. I remember thinking and hearing a lot about different churches that were getting very upset with this particular, issue. It kind of showed some of the racial challenges that the church has faced over the years, legitimate challenges between that African Americans were coming forward, like in the beginning of the story that I said, and they were coming forward and saying, you guys, do you do realize how we feel like we've been treated all over these years? And it still continues today when we go into stores and people give a stink eye or we drive down the street and a police officer stops us. This was their perception. Just like the perception of these Greek-speaking Jewish Hellenists felt like they were getting skimped in the daily distribution. And they were saying this out loud, but others were saying, hey, you know what? You need to be quiet. You're bringing race into this subject and you're bringing race, blah, blah, blah. And I remember thinking to myself, this is a really important issue. It's a big time issue, but why is every church right now focused so much on this particular issue to the detriment of the mission? Because this issue is important and valuable as it is, and it is. is not the mission of proclamation of the gospel. Should we deal with it? Yes. This passage will show that we should deal with it, but we should deal with it in a way that does not distract us from the gospel and its proclamation. Like I said, you can agree or disagree with my examples. Here's my third one. How about recently we all have an opinion about COVID? I mean, honestly, you talk to anybody and they'll give you an opinion about, you know, we know words like PCR tests. Well, they're good and they're bad. And the vaccine, well, it's good or it's bad. It should be mandated. It shouldn't be mandated. Why aren't you wearing a mask? Why are you wearing a mask? And that whole fight has come right into the church so that we're all kind of like, you know, amateur epidemiologists right now because we read on Twitter or Google what we can believe. And we all have a view on this. And we bring it into, we fight about it. Is it important? Yes. Should we obey the government? Should we not obey the government? Is it good for people? Is it not good for people? It's important. These are important issues that should be sorted out. The problem is it becomes such a main focus of the church that the mission of the church, which is why we're here, the proclamation of the gospel, gets lost. Because we're so busy fighting about our particular political agenda or epidemiological viewpoint. Now, we've got to keep the proclamation of the gospel front and center. We must, like the apostles, be uncompromising on our calling. Right, that's my first point. Second point, shorter. I want to show you that even though we're uncompromising on our mission, on our calling, we should be compromising on our power. Look at verse 2 with me. The 12 summoned the full number of the disciples and said, it's not right that we should give up preaching the word of God to serve tables. This is where we just stopped our last section. Therefore, now here's their plan. Therefore, brothers, I want you to pick out from among you seven men. Remember that. There's seven men who are chosen to do this job. They have to be of good repute, full of the spirit and of wisdom, and we're going to appoint them to this duty. But we will devote ourselves to prayer and ministry of the word, right? We're going to stick with the things that really matter in terms of the mission going forward, okay? Here's what I want to show you really quickly. There's four things that I want to point out regarding how they made this decision that are really interesting. Here's the first. The guys that they chose were qualified, right? Pick out among you seven men of good repute. That means that their reputation was upstanding in the community. When people were asked about them at their workplace or whatever, they're like, no, he's a really good, ethical guy, full of integrity. They also had to be full of the Spirit, meaning they had to demonstrate maybe the fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness. And those are not feelings that they had so much as things that you could say to them and say, that person looks like a full of the Spirit Christian because of their character and the way that they act. And they needed to be full of wisdom. We're not just going to pick anybody, you know, whether or not they have any kind of thought regarding how to fix this problem. We need to have some people who have some experience and thoughtfulness about this issue. The reason I point this out is that usually when churches come to pick people to solve issues, they usually pick the rich people. They usually pick the people who've, you know, made a killing in the stock market. Or they usually pick that kind of thing for whatever reason, because it's like, well, they're successful. What's interesting here is that the successfulness is not really in play. It's got to be people who have good reputation, have good character, and they're people who have the ability to reason through some of this stuff in a remarkable way, in a clear way. You had to have all three of those. If you just were like really good at solving problems, but your character stunk, no, we're not including you. Leadership in God's church is a more important thing than just the pragmatics of it. So they were qualified. I said there were four of these. The other one is they were wisely appointed. I want you to see this right here. Therefore, brothers, pick out seven men of good repute, full of the Spirit wisdom, who we're going to appoint to this duty. We're going to devote ourselves to prayer and the ministry of the word, okay? I'll go down here. And what they said pleased the whole gathering. So here's who they chose. Stephen, a man full of faith and the Holy Spirit. Philip, Procurus, Nicanor, Timon, it's not Pumbaa, and Parmenas, and Santa Claus, a proselyte of Antioch. It's not Santa Claus, it's just, I'm goofing around. Have you ever been down and seen two stores on the street, and maybe they're, you know, they're law firms, and the law firm of Stephen, James, and John. And right next door to it is maybe the law firm of Jagmeet, Harvinder, and Balbir. Now, when you're looking at it, you instinctively know that there are two different, these are law firms that have partners of different racial backgrounds. One of them is probably kind of Western, probably white, North Americans, and the other one is an Indian law firm. And you know that by the name. Similarly, in their day, there were certain names that were Greek, and there were certain names that were Hebrew. The problem that they're having is a bunch of Greek-speaking Jews are frustrated because they think they're getting held back, or they're getting less than what they deserve. And so they're the ones making the complaint. So who do they choose? This name is Greek. 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 They chose a bunch of Greek-speaking guys to solve a Greek-speaking offense. It's amazing. It's like a church, if there's a racial disagreement in the church and there are African-Americans feeling like they're getting slighted, it's like the church saying, right, we're going to appoint all the Africans, because they're the ones feeling slighted, and they're the ones who know their community, and they're the ones who are full of wisdom on how to fix things for their community. We're going to appoint all of them to it. Not a single white person is going to be a part of it. Some people would fight about that. In our day, they'd be like, well, wait a minute, they're going to be biased. Yeah. But they believed that they were full of the Holy Spirit, and the Spirit was actually going to lead them. So they were qualified, they were wisely appointed, and they were empowered. Notice at the end here of this little section, they set before the apostles these guys, and they prayed and they laid their hands on all of them. And the word of God continued to increase, and the number of the disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem. They laid their hands up. In other words, they're laying their hands on them saying, we trust the Holy Spirit's work through you, brother, 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 brother. And they let them loose. They empower them. I remember when I was working as a budget car rental, I was on the phone with somebody we were trying to rent a car to, and my boss was in the background, and he kept saying to me, say exactly what I say. Repeat exactly after me. And I was like, this is really weird. I said, do you want to talk to him? No, 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 just you repeat exactly what I tell you. And so he would say something, and I would kind of summarize it. He'd say something, and I kind of summarize. Anyway, once the phone call's over, he said, what's wrong with you? Can't you repeat after me? You didn't repeat exactly what I said, to which I was like, look, if you want somebody who's going to be a robot, you should just hire one. Like, if you're going to hire me and you're going to let me do this job, you should empower me to do the job. If you want to do the job yourself, you should go get a little robot, a little parrot, and he can parrot everything you say. That's not what happens here. You don't have micromanagers standing over the tops of them saying, I'm not sure we can really trust these Greek-speaking people. I mean, after all, they're from outside of Jerusalem. So let's just make sure they make the right decision. No, it was actual full trust. You guys are going to make the right decision because we can't sacrifice the preaching of the word of God and prayer. The last thing that's really interesting, and you notice I made a point of this when it was way back here. Seven men. Seven men? You could have picked one guy. Why do you pick seven? Why are seven people necessary to make this decision? Well, this is a common theme in the Bible. Jesus chooses 12. I know there are theological reasons for that. You know, he's reconstituting Israel and all that, but he also wanted friends around. He also believed that it was important for a team to be doing the ministry together. The Apostle Paul, he never goes anywhere alone. If he has to go somewhere alone, he's like, I'm not going. I need to have my friends with me. When he's in prison and he's dying in prison, he just wants to have a friend. He begs and pleads, come, visit me, come, be a part of the ministry, because he knows it gets horribly lonely. And that, you know, we're a body, he says in 1 Corinthians 12. And all the gifts working together make it happen. Right. My point, and the thing I really want to focus as we finish here, is that plural leadership in the Bible, in the New Testament, plural leadership that means more than one person working together in a team is frustrating, right? It's slow, it's irritating, but it's biblical. It seems to be the way that God wants his church to function. You know, that's not the way that our society thinks of leadership. Plurality bogs stuff down. There's a girl joke about committees. What is a committee? It's a group of the unwilling picked from the unfit to do the unnecessary. You can hear the attitude of people of our day. Come on, why would we pick a committee? If we want to get something done, we'd have, you know, like one person picked to do the thing, and then we'd give them full power and they could just, you know, go out and do everything they want. And if nobody wants to do it, they can just get out of my way, throw them off. That tends to be the way that our culture views leadership in many cases. We love the lone, I can do it all by myself leader, right? That's why we love Jason Bourne. He doesn't need any help. Jason Bourne didn't need any help. Like 10 guys attack Jason Bourne, he's got it taken care of, right? Those of you who are older remember, like, when I was a kid, I watched the Kung Fu movies with Bruce Lee, and there's like 100 guys around him, and he beating everyone up. And afterwards, you're like, yeah, nobody can take Bruce Lee. He alone can dominate all things. We love the single hero movies, the single hero idea. Me against the world, and we can take care of it. Let nobody get in my way. I did it my way. Sorry, Frank Sinatra. Christians, I think, have embraced that idea. You can see it when you go on websites of some churches. On the front of their website is the picture of the pastor. You know, here I am. This church is equal to me. You will equate this church with me and my personality. Sometimes when we talk about churches, we're like, hey, do you know about that particular church? And you're like, oh yeah, that's Joe Smith's church. Yeah, you can hear it. We equate the church with the individual who's preaching. That's the church. See, single leader, man of God appointed, touch not the Lord's anointed. We say things like that as if there's a single person that's anointed in the New Testament for that to happen. And yes, there are Gideons in the Old Testament stuff, but when you come to the New Testament, what you find is teams. You find teams over and over and over again. In fact, Paul, when he has a chance to tell Titus what he's supposed to do when he's making these churches function, he says, this is why I left you in Crete, so that you might put what remained into order and appoint elders. Elders in every town, as I directed you. I don't want you to just point one elder here and one elder there and one elder there, and they're just going to run the church like they're some kind of dictator. I want you to appoint a plurality of qualified men who can do the work together. So look, let me finish by just giving you three benefits of this kind of leadership and why it's so important for us as a church to be doing it. Here are three benefits. If you go down the path of broad-based leadership, team-based leadership, the church is not overly dependent on any one person. I remember years ago, I had a young guy who was working together with me, and he started a ministry. It was a ministry to young adults. It became quite popular. In fact, he was a really good organizer. But he called himself the CEO of the ministry. That was, I mean, literally, he would actually put posters that said, come to this particular ministry, CEO, and then he put his name. It's like, oh, I don't know if that's kind of way we view it in the church. But I was too young to give any kind of like feedback to him about that. But what happened, of course, is when he decided to leave the church, the whole ministry died because everything was hanging and dependent upon him. Lasting ministry will involve many people. Lasting ministry works on the principle of next man up. Lasting ministry has virtual benches of people who you're training and equipping so that when the first guy, the first girl depart, the next one's there. Broad-based, team-based ministry. Secondly, the church benefits with this team-based ministry, benefits from different gifts and perspectives. When I first became a lead pastor years and years ago, I think it was about 16 years ago when I in my old church, they hired me and then they said to me, the elder board got together and they said, listen, we're happy to have you as our lead pastor, but one of the things we need you to know is that you need a sober second thought. That was their language. You need a sober second thought. Probably because I get drunk on my opinions or something. What they meant by that is, Jeff, you have a desire to have 15 different ideas and you're excited about all of them. What you need is someone to curate those ideas and to say, that one stinks, this one has potential. Ever since then, I've come to realize they were absolutely right that when I am surrounded by a team of people with different giftings, everything works. But if you leave me alone, man, we end up doing stuff that you're like, why are we doing this? The church benefits from different gifts and perspectives. I've been working together with a lead team here at Harvest for the last little while, and we've been facing some challenging, difficult decisions, and I'm just telling you that without them, I don't know what I would have done. One of them is putting up Excel spreadsheets everywhere and following a procedure, and I'm like, this is killing me. We're sitting in a room for 10 hours having a meeting. Why can't we have the meeting in 20 minutes? But everything on those spreadsheets was integral to what we were trying to do. I thank God for the team. We're better as a team. And finally, you know, broadly led churches can always grow in impact. Single-led churches can only grow to the left, to the height of their leader, but broad churches can grow much bigger. Towers of impact. My daughter, when she was little, I was making mega blocks, and I was building. I always wanted to see how high I could get the tower with like a single block at the bottom and then have it go up. And of course, it would always fall over. And she would tell me repeatedly, Daddy, Daddy, build it bigger. Daddy, build it bigger, wider. Build it wider. Build it wider at the bottom. Build it wider. Okay, honey, we built it wider. And of course, then because it's wider and it's moving it between, you know, it's like the Burj Al Khalifa or whatever, and it's going way up high, you know, Eiffel Tower high. And that's the way it works. The broader the base of qualified, full of the Spirit leaders that you have appointed to work together in a team, the higher the impact can go. So look, we are Harvest Bible Chapel. Our goal is not to just rely on one or two, but on many for the leading and flourishing of this church. We aim to build it wider. I want you to join us. And let's just see how high this tower of impact can go. Amen.
Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, you are holy, you are righteous, you are sovereign. Lord, we pray that you would build your church. That God, I pray that you would heal any divisions that are among us, that you would make us a church that is unified for the mission of the gospel, that we are about what you are about, Lord. And Lord, I pray that you stir in our hearts anything that is hindering us from being unified together and being able to serve you. God, we love you and we're expectant. You are good to us, God. We praise you for who you are. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and respond.
how good the Lord has been to us. What a great truth to stamp on our hearts as we go out into this week. Hey, if you have a need, if you would like someone to pray with you, some of our staff will be up front. We don't want you to go home with a burden that you walked in here with. Share that with someone. And also, if you're new, I would love the opportunity to meet with you. I'll be out in the lobby by the welcome sign. And as for all of us, as you go out on mission this week for Jesus, know that you are loved.